Welcome to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Be warned, the discussions in this podcast may contain detailed spoilers. For spoiler-free reviews of newly released films, be sure to check out our show on our YouTube channel. Enter at your own risk and enjoy the show.
Listeners, tell them all, whoever comes, whoever it is, Reviews Without Remorse will judge them. We'll judge them all. I am David, he is Joe, and this is episode 117. And in this show, we will discuss HBO TV series Watchmen, based on the Alan Moore and Dave Gibbons graphic novel, got a trailer of sorts. It Chapter 2 also gets its first trailer. See what I did there? It, get it, huh? never mind. In sad news, we have a triple play of RIP as Reviews Without Remorse mourns the passing of Alvin Sargent, Doris Day, and the tremendous, tremendous Tim Conway. And then, forgoing pet murder for paying off old debts, Keanu Reeves returns for the second in this fascinating action series as we review John Wick, Chapter 2. Hi, my man.
Hello, my friend. Good to be back.
Yes, yes. We've had some issues, but we're finally back in the fold and ready to get started.
Let's get to it.
We are no one. We are everyone. And we are invisible. Tick, tock, tick,
tock, tick, tock. So, the show is being created by a man named Damon Lindelof. Now, Damon Lindelof is infamous for being, shall we say, snobbish when people complained about the ending of Lost, which is a show that he helped co-create. He is also listed as a writer of Star Trek Into Darkness. He is also listed as a writer of Prometheus, of Cowboys and Indians, of World War Z. Do you see what I'm getting at here? Are you seeing kind of, you know, the idea that I'm coming across here? Okay, this is the guy that they get to do a TV series based on The Watchmen, which isn't even really based on the actual comic book itself, or what? What the hell did that trailer even mean? Joe, you're not as close to the product as I am. What was your impression?
Well, yeah, that's just it. I honestly, I couldn't really make heads or tails of it, and I'll be the first to admit, I did not read the original graphic novel. I've had it. I've literally held it in my hand. People have lent it to me, and I've said, yes, I will get to it. And I just never got to it. I did see the movie, which I enjoy very much, which is usually my defense of Zack Snyder. I say, well, Watchmen is good. I really like The Watchmen. I think it's a great, that is a really great film. So my exposure is limited, so when I saw this trailer, I kind of went, oh, all right, okay. It doesn't look to me like anything that I know from that film. It looks kind of like an afterthought. Like, is this, I'm guessing maybe this is a series that stems from that story, like a continuation?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is, because Jeremy Irons is actually playing the part of Adrian Veidt. He was the guy who came up with the plan in the movie. And Jeremy Irons is a bunch of years older than that guy, so I'm assuming this is a sequel of sorts.
And the Army of Rorschach people, I guess? I guess that's kind of like the tribute now? Now he's a martyr?
Well, yeah, I guess. I'm not 100% sure where they're going with this. All I know is that as I was watching it emotionally, I felt nothing. Okay, yeah. Not true. I kind of felt a little giddy when I saw Don Johnson say TikTok. That was it. That was the only moment that I was kind of like, ooh, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, but I'm with you, though. I saw it, and honestly, nothing really about it made me go, oh, my God, I need to see this.
Yeah.
Nothing at all, really.
I suppose I'll check it out, but yeah, it's
going to fall into the category of, if I hear something good, I will check it out. If I don't, I will probably never give it a peek.
Yes, may I help you?
I used to live here.
Won't you come in? It's the least I can do. Is it like you remember?
Cleaner.
Well, you feel free to look around while I get the water boiling.
Your hair is winter fire. January embers.
Trailer for It was fascinating. I kind of liked the way that they did where they played out kind of a scene from the movie to kind of get you back into the groove and remind you who all the people were. And I actually found myself a little creeped out just by the 2 minutes that was in that trailer.
Yeah, I am with you. I thought that was pretty good. I mean, it's enough to show you that this is, you know, I mean, again, it's a well shot, a well executed film. The creeps are going to be pretty genuine. So that was probably even smarter than just giving you the typical trailer, you know, the montage of cool shots and a couple lines that are, you know, the wow lines. This was a pretty smart idea. And I will say, yes, it definitely got me ready to see It Part 2, because I enjoyed the first one very much. I like how they split it into two chapters. It made perfect sense. So, yeah, and I'm interested in the cast. The cast looks good, looks solid. So I kind of feel like I'm ready. I'm on board.
Yeah. I also kind of feel like I don't want to see any more trailers for this movie, you know?
Yeah.
I feel like I've gotten enough. I know it. I don't want any more, because I feel like they haven't really given away the really big scares. They just gave the creepy vibe, and I'd like to be surprised.
Yeah. Agreed, right. Mission accomplished, you got my ticket money, so.
Hey, who knows? Maybe we'll... Are we reviewing it? Is it on our list? I don't remember. I think we kept adding it and taking it off.
I think you are correct. I think it did... it might have fallen to the wayside between other things that popped up. But, yeah, hopefully we can give it some little airtime, at least in the news portion, I suppose.
In this typical town, in this comfortable home, three ordinary people are about to live an extraordinary story.
But starting all over again, the lying, the covering up, the disappearing for hours, I will not stand for it. I can't stand it. I really can't.
All right, Alvin Sargent is... Look, I'm big with writing. I like screenwriters. I like people that actually make the words. And it's only within the past couple of years that screenwriters have gotten their day in court. And his, Alvin Sargent's passing on May the 9th, 2019. He died in Seattle, actually. He died in my neck of the woods, which kind of killed me. I didn't realize he was so local. This one's kind of a big one. His first like bit of notoriety, he wrote the screenplay for the movie Paper Moon with Tatum O'Neill and Ryan O'Neill, and I think he got an Oscar nomination for that. He also wrote Bobby Deerfield, Julia, now The Electric Horseman. He did an uncredited rewrite, but he wrote the screenplay for Ordinary People, which was a huge movie. It was like the directorial debut of Robert Redford and was highly well reviewed. He also wrote the story for What About Bob? Yes, that's right, Bill Murray's What About Bob? But to me, what he probably contributed most that you would appreciate, besides other people's money and Hero and Unfaithful, he wrote the screenplay for Spider-Man 2, considered the best Spider-Man movie of all the Spider-Man movies. And that's why I'm bringing him up.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, his last credited screenplay is The Amazing Spider-Man. I'm not 100% sure why he would do something like that, but whatever. Good for you, man. No, I had to bring him up because he really did. If you want to point to the moment where people started taking superhero movies seriously, it's Spider-Man 2. There was no longer a game. Reviewers loved that movie with good reason. We loved it too. It was probably our favorite of the entire Spider-Man series. But, and this is his responsibility, so I needed to do a shout-out for him. Absolutely.
Yeah. I'm with you 100% too, and it's really nice to see somebody who can be so well-rounded.
Yeah,
you
know, exactly.
You would think somebody who did something like Ordinary People would probably thumb their nose at the idea of doing a comic book movie. And again, it's not just, you know, some might say, well, he'll, you know, some people will do anything for a paycheck, but he brought his A game. He brought heart and soul into that script, you know, so that was a fine piece of work. Like you said, that really was a well-respected all around film. So in the Amazing Spider-Man part, I can almost sympathize and say, well, I don't find the story of that film terrible. I think there's a lot in the execution. And again, somebody goes to him and says, okay, we're rebooting, so now you can go back and do the origin story. Oh, okay. So, I mean, it's you know, script-wise, it's passable. I think there's a lot of other problems with that film. But, so, you know, that's a hell of a career.
Indeed. Rest in peace, Mr. Sargent. I salute you.
Stars shining bright above you. Night breezes seem to whisper, I love you. Birds singing in the sycamore trees. Dream a little dream of me.
Okay, this one's going to be a hard one. Doris Day, born April 3rd, 1922, died on May the 13th, 2019. Doris Day is probably best known for the 50s screwball comedy style movies. I think that was kind of her biggest claim to fame, the Pajama Game, stuff like that, which they kind of skewered in the movie Down with Love with Ewan McGregor and Renee Zellweger. She was huge. Like, she was a huge commodity for the longest time. She was like the it woman of the 50s and the 60s, even having her own TV show for nearly 5 years, for almost 6 years. And she retired after that and just disappeared. But if you ever want to have some fun, go to her IMDb page and just look at her credits. Like, she has listed a total of 43 acting credits. That's it. But her songs, the songs that she sang, are listed in over 122 different productions.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yep. Now, I bring her up because absolutely, this is a woman who needs to be honored. I don't know a hell of a lot about her. I was not a fan of those type of movies, so I didn't watch them very much. I did not watch Please Don't Eat the Daisy or Pillow Talk or The Tunnel of Love or Teacher's Pet or The Pajama Game. Didn't watch any of those. Those were, growing up, those were chick flicks, and you know, you just never get around to it again. But now I kind of feel like maybe I should take a retrospect for the poor lady.
I would say it's probably worth a look, really, because it is a part of movie history. I mean, it is a subgenre, you know, genre. So it's worth probably noting just for that reason. I mean, this, like you said, this was a hugely popular type of filmmaking back then, and yeah, she was an icon of a type. So I think, in terms of that, it's very worth checking out.
Hello. Hello, doctor. Well, that'll be $20. $20? You haven't done anything yet. $15, maybe. Look, doctor, please listen to me. I have a terrible toothache. I am in terrible pain. I want you to do something to stop the pain. Either fill the tooth or pull it.
Oh, gosh. Why? C's.
C's?
Yeah, see, in dental school, in filling and pulling, I only got C's. That was just kind of an average grade. I got A's in cleaning, though. You want me to clean it for you?
Will it stop the pain?
No, but it'll look great. Boy, I can polish it right up.
Give me the C's. Give me the C's.
C's. Oh, boy. Gosh, well, I cheated on my final.
Born December 15th, 1933, Tim Conway was the funniest man alive.
I'm just going to come out and say it. Tim Conway, you know, and this is going to make me sound like an old fart, and I don't mean it to make it sound like an old fart. Tim Conway is one of those guys who, in his delivery and his mannerisms, can get more of a laugh out of you without resorting to vulgarity or going into a completely, what they used to call it, like blue territory or something like that.
Mm.
This man's gift of improvisation, of, you know, just ridiculousness and told in such a deadpan way, this man's complete torture of Harvey Korman to make him laugh was truly some of the finest moments in television that I knew growing up. I mean, I've been going crazy this week watching a retrospect about him. There was one where Red Fox was announcing Emmy nominations, and it was just announcing the Emmy nomination. So he's just like, the nominees are Tim Conway. So Tim Conway went up on stage, like, as, you know, acting as if he won. And when it turned out that Harvey Korman won at one point, Harvey Korman's giving a speech, and there's Tim Conway, and he's kind of resting his head on Harvey Korman's arm and just looking up at him with these, like, these eyes of like, oh, he's so cool. He was outstanding. Mm. He was so funny without ever having to go, like, really, really vulgar. I don't have a problem with vulgar humor, but I will always admire somebody that can get genuine humor without going too far.
Well, he was the genuine article, you know? I mean, you don't have to really just kind of go for shock laughs as long as you can really just be funny. And yeah, I it's when you just look up just random clips of him, like on the Carol Burnett show, like try to find a clip where he's not making everyone else hysterical. Like just him doing, and it's funny too, because like if you didn't know who they were and you saw them in a lineup, you know, you saw Harvey Korman, Carol Burnett, everybody else, you'd think like, well, who's this guy?
Vicky,
like, he's
Lawrence.
The most unassuming. Yeah, he's the most unassuming of the looking of the bunch. But he again, Harvey Korman, who looks like a guy who is a guy who has a gift for comedy. It's Tim Conway always cracking up Harvey Korman, like he is always killing them. Like, they can barely get through sketches without just like you'd think they're all smoking pot all day, that they can't just stop laughing hysterical. So, yeah, I mean, he is absolutely amazing. I mean, I watch some of his stuff now. And again, we're going back 40 years.
I mean, easily.
I could watch his clips today and like laugh hard today as I would back then. I mean, you know, he really was something else. And his films, by the way, I remember watching, there was a lot of films that he did with like Don Knotts and stuff.
Oh, yeah, the Apple Dumpling Gang.
Right, all that stuff. There was one called Private Eyes that when it was always on cable when we were young, we watched it over
I
and over.
I love that movie. It's so right? dumb and so awesome.
Oh, my God. But like even like silly stuff like that, which I wouldn't even call like the best use of his comedy, because I think the TV was really where you saw exactly what he was made of. But everything he was in was always funny. So yeah, he was a true talent.
Started off in the 1960s as Ensign Charlie Parker in McHale's Navy, and worked steadily for God up until 2016. He finally died May 14th, 2019 at the age of 85. Wow. I didn't even realize he was that young. I thought he was like in his 90s.
Yeah. Yeah, he's been around for a long time.
Oh. Seriously, just go to YouTube, you know, and use the search terms Tim Conway, Carol Burnett.
Yeah.
You'll have a great time. Rest in peace, funny man. Thank you for everything.
Big time.
Welcome to Rome. Is this a formal event or a social affair?
Social.
How many buttons?
Two.
And what style?
Tactical.
Mr. Wick, do enjoy your party.
After returning to the criminal underworld to repay a debt, John Wick discovers that a large bounty has been put on his life. Written by Derek Kolsted, based on characters created by Derek Kolsted, directed by Chad Stahelski, John Wick, Chapter 2.
give me a gun.
Did it get better?
What do you think?
I'm not 100% sure. I was kind of amazed. You know, most sequel. Let's think back to the granddaddy of action movies. Let's think back to the movie that you and I gushed over so much that we started sounding like that Chris Farley sketch from Saturday Night Live. Do you remember when he dropped the bomb down the elevator shaft in Die Hard? That was cool, right? Now, the second one we were kind of on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it had lost something. There's always something with action movie sequels where it seems like almost as if the creators didn't know what they had with the first one, so they think they understand it and get it wrong with the second one.
Mm.
It's like a pattern. But here, it's like, no, we knew what we were doing, and we're doing it again. I really had a blast with this movie as much as the first one. Still found myself, I mean, this is like, I wound up watching it twice, you know, because I watched it at home and then I was watching it at work, and I couldn't keep my eyes off of it. It is such a visually appealing movie. The action is so beautifully directed, and Keanu Reeves, man, just kind of oozes this charm that you root for him no matter what. Guy barely says maybe 80 words in the entire freaking movie. and you're rooting for the son of a bitch.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoyed this movie. I enjoyed the further deepening of the world. Maybe one or two little silliness bits when it comes to the world building, but other than that, dude, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, they got it right. This is the secret, having an actor who's passionate about it and having the same writer, director, pretty much the same crew back again makes all the difference to making an action series. And since they're going to be in part three, it's kind of got my fingers crossed that hopefully this quality continues.
Mm.
Joseph.
Well, it's funny that you opened up by saying that, in sequels, they tend to not really understand what they got right with the first one, and they think they've got it, so they go forward with a certain angle or whatever, and sometimes they're going down the wrong road. I agree with you in spirit with what you said about that in terms of this film here, where they did understand, they did embrace what people liked about the first one and what people responded to about the first one, and they really sort of went forward. I think what they did was they said, well, everybody loves the action. Everyone loves the world, the underworld part of it. And that's sort of what they went forward with this one. I was not quite as crazy about that idea because I sort of felt like they took, and I can understand why they did it, certainly. In the first one, I kind of felt that the film started out very grounded. You see John Wick at home, you see him at an abandoned airport, at a gas station, like it all looks very real worldish. So when they did kind of, step into the land of Oz, so to speak, you could feel you were entering a different world. Well, here, they sort of start out in Wonderland, frankly. It starts out with an over-the-top action piece, which was, of course, great. He gets home just long enough for somebody to knock on the door and blow the house up. And of course, again, it's a very typical cliche, so I'm not really going to pick on it too much. But, seriously, if you're the action hero and a grenade lands right at your feet, it will just blow you somewhere to safety and you'll be fine. You'll brush yourself off and have a couple scratches here and there, and that's it. So it sort of already started out kind of fantastic. And I can sort of understand that because, again, once you've already crossed into the world of John Wick and John Wick Part 1, what's the point? What's the point of kind of trying to back out again to say, oh, look, it's grounded, just to sort of go back in and get over the top and crazy? But this one really did just kind of, it just sort of pulled out all the stops, just said, the hell with it. We're just going to go crazy and just give people a complete, feast of action, of color, of style. And again, it's great. It's great. But I did find it to be not quite the Thinking Man's thriller as the first one was, and just kind of more over the top fun, which is fine. And again, I'm not, you know, I'm going to start off with a negative and kind of get very positive, because again, I do think this is a great film. It's a great time. And I also was reminded, by the way, very quickly, why I called it Headshots the Movie the first time we ever talked about it. Because, and it was funny because they did address the idea. I mean, again, now we're kind of getting over the top in terms of like Q gadgets, you know, like now he's got a suit that is bulletproof.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, all right. And again, I'm saying to myself, well, if he has that, how come everyone else? Well, I take it back, because I'm now, he has it, so I guess everyone else does, which is why it's nothing but headshots. I think that's why, basically, they're sort of explaining why it's just going to be headshot, 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 mm-hmm. because now everybody's got this kind of over-the-top, you know, bulletproof clothing. So, anyway, that said, yes, it does deliver on everything it promises. Over-the-top stunts, style, everything, and it is absolutely a tour de force in that respect.
You know, it is over the top, and that's okay. I think there's anything wrong with it. In many ways, the first one started, you know, here's the way I look at it. Think of the first John Wick like Iron Man. Like the first Iron Man, where they really tried their best to be like, okay, we need to try to at least introduce this in a way that the public can be like, okay, I can understand this. This is good. Keep it real and relatively grounded. Okay? And then the only difference is whereas with the Marvel Cinematic Universe movies, they kind of slowly started introducing, okay, but then there's this. Oh, and then there's this. Okay,
right,
now
right,
we've
right.
got cosmic stuff. Now we got... Whereas in the John Wick movies, like, they basically started doing that in the first one. It was like, grounded, 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 and then he takes the sledgehammer out, and the minute the guy starts telling the story of Baba Yaga, that's it. That's where the movie starts like, okay... Now the fun really begins. Because
yeah.
everything that happened from that point forward, as far as I'm concerned, is just too hyper-realistic, but fun.
Yeah. Yeah, I right. And I agree with that 1,000%. It is over the top and fun, and there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, again, not every film has to be grounded. So, yeah, I think what you're saying is absolutely correct. But again, it's I guess the freshness is sort of what I'm kind of lamenting from the first one. The first one did have that. I mean, again, if you were going to do like a Wizard of Oz 2, are you going to really bother with the first half hour in Kansas? Or are you going to just get back into, you know, the fun color stuff? Yeah, so we're just going to get right back into things. You know, but again, like I said, I kind of felt like it is kind of just sort of almost unrelenting in its... I mean, this is really more about stunts, action, than it is about story. I mean, I honestly, there are even parts of the story that I don't really know if I'm following correctly. For example, I mean, the guy shows up with the marker. Okay,
right.
And I almost feel like honestly, when John Wick turns down the marker, and 2 seconds later his house is completely destroyed. It's almost like I'm starting to say to myself, all right, maybe John Wick is not as smart as the movie's telling me he is. Because, well, what did you think? And again, it's like after the last one and now this one, it's like, well, how did you get that far into this world? How did you get to the point where you're at? How did you get to be so well-respected? If it seems like every time you have some rule to follow, you decide to go do something else. And again, the first one absolutely positively lays out the case for why he did it. I mean, it goes to the trouble to say, this was his wife, she's dead, here's the puppy gets clobbered. So it's like, okay, I would go crazy and murder this guy too, you know, if he killed my puppy like that. This one skips the steps. This one decides, you know, somebody shows up, here's a marker, and he says no. He doesn't, there's no real reason why he says no. I mean, again, he made his living as an assassin. Well, this guy comes up with one last marker that you are obliged to honor if you live in this world, and he just says no. And he says, no, please find somebody else. Like, I can't do it. Well, you just got finished murdering, like, 100 people. Like, one more is gonna make a break? Like, why is he saying no at this point? He didn't know who it was. He didn't know, like, who he was being asked. I mean, he could have just said, well, who is it, where, why? And then, I mean, honestly, if the conversation went, well, okay, who is it? Well, it's my sister. No, I'm not going to kill your sister. You know, whatever. I know her. I'm not going to kill her. But he doesn't. He goes to the trouble. He says no. The house gets blown up, and then he does it anyway, you know? So it kind of leaves me kind of going, like, all right, again, like, you could tell where, you know, the priorities were in this film, and storytelling was not quite the priority. And like I said, I'm not going to spend the whole hour being the turd in the punch bowl. You know, I don't, there's nothing wrong with an over the top action movie. So, but again, I didn't quite get the exact same charge I got from the first one.
I kind of took it as, I mean, and again, you're absolutely 100% correct. They didn't really bring it across very well, but I interpreted him turning him down because he knew that if he was coming to him, it was something huge, and he didn't want to do it. He didn't want to have to do something huge. He knew who the guy was. He knew, you know, that he had done him a huge favor, and he literally just got home from his killing spree, and he was like, just, I took it as a no. It's asking too much right now. You have to find somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And it turned out he was right. He not only was he after a seat at the high table, but then he portrayed him anyway. So that's why I interpreted that, you know, he was actually being smart, that he knew that this was not what it appeared to be, and he didn't want to get involved in any of it. And it's caused the final destruction for him, because then after that, he's basically become persona non grata around the world. And it's only because of his friendship with the Ian McShane character, with Winston, that he's even still alive by the end of the movie.
Mm. Yeah, and that's a perfectly good point. I mean, I could definitely get that this, he's, okay, if this guy is in my house asking for Earth, it's not going to be for something casual. So I don't want to do it. And that's perfectly fair.
But they could have done a better job of getting that across. I 100% agree with you. If that was where they were going.
Right, yeah. And right. And I still sort of say, okay, but if you know that this much trouble is going to come down the pike, I mean, seriously, he basically goes to the Winston character and says, this guy blew up my house. And he was like, well, what'd you expect? Like, even he is sort of making my point, saying, well, what did you think was going to happen? And by the way, like, I didn't quite get that part about being betrayed afterwards, because again, it's so kind of like, and this is the trouble when you start to do this whole thing with the world, you know, the whole underworld of these assassins, and they all know each other. I mean, the guy hiring John Wick is also sort of a member of this elite group. He's not somebody who's outside the group, like hiring somebody who's in the group to do his dirty work. It's almost like anybody who's anybody is in this underworld. Like it's almost like they're making it too big. Because now I can't really understand. Well, first of all, why can't that guy just get anyone else in this underworld to do this job? I mean, again, to bump off his sister didn't really seem like that hard of a job. I don't know. And then when John Wick actually does it, all of a sudden now the bounty is on John Wick by the guy. Like, it's almost like, so the guy hires John Wick to kill the sister. He kills the sister, and then the bad guy puts a bounty on John Wick. But all this is happening within this network, in this secret underground. So why doesn't Winston say, hey, wait a second, no, you can't do that. You can't put a bounty on John Wick because he did your job. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm kind of getting lost in who's who and what's happening, why. And I almost feel like it's primarily because they're expanding so much on this big world to make it seem like everyone knows everything. And this code reaches out to pretty much anybody. To the point, basically, by the way, at the end when they're in Central Park and he's talking to Winston and he says, you know, you're excommunicado, and like everyone in the park freezes. And I kind of went, all right, no. Like, you can't tell me that everybody in the world now is in this thing. Like, that was too much. I kind of felt like that was just too much. I did like it when I liked right after that, by the way, when he was running out of the park, and now he's running, limping, and he's looking at everyone who's now looking at him. And I liked the idea that John Wick now doesn't know, are they looking at me because they see a crazy man running past, or are they out to get me? And as the viewer, I think it's like the people who were looking at him, they did a good job of saying, like, it wasn't like anybody who looked at him was wearing a dark suit and just looked evil. No, I mean, there was some regular people who were also turning and looking, and John Wick is like, I can't tell who's who anymore. Like, now everybody's out to get me, and I just don't know who's who and why. So I thought that was well done. But the shot of everybody freezing and looking, I kind of went, eh, no. So...
There are a lot of moments of over-the-topness when it comes to the development of the story. You're right. It doesn't make sense that if it's such a well-known secret that the brother took out the sister, then him, you know, looking to... Why even bother offing? Why even... Hold on. Okay. He says it's a matter of honor that he has to kill John Wick because he killed his sister. But why even bother? Everybody knows. So that is kind of a huge plot hole.
Yeah, right. Like, everybody knows what's what. Yeah, so I didn't quite get why the whole... Again, why would he put a contract out on John Wick? If everyone knows how the game is played, everyone knows the rules, why would you betray John Wick for doing exactly what he was supposed to do?
Technically was compelled to do.
Yeah, right. Right. This society that prides itself on the rules and regulations of how, you know, this is how we keep things civilized because we have rules. Okay, perfectly fair. But then with that in mind, well, why, you know, exactly. Like, why does this happen? Why is John Wick get portrayed, et cetera, et cetera? I don't know. It wasn't really good. I will say this, and again, I'm not, just to prove to you that I'm not going to spend an hour bagging on this movie, because again, I did like it. I did like the stuff that they did. And again, you can't have your cake and eat it too. I liked the parts where, like, he goes to the sommelier and does a tasting, you know, and that's like all that kind of gearing up stuff was really cool. So again, I guess you can't have one without the other. I guess if you're going to just do the over the top, you know, underworld stuff, okay, it's, you know, but you're not going to get a story that's perfectly logical either. I don't know. Am I asking too much?
Eh, it might be. We likened this to the action movies that we had when we were growing up back in the 80s, for the first one at least. And weirdly, this is still in line with that, yeah, okay, the plot is a convenience to get the character from point A to point B, and the logic behind it, it doesn't always make sense. And I can't really defend it like that. And you know, it's funny. I hadn't even really considered the plot hole that is him putting the hit out on John. Yeah. You know, it's like if Winston didn't come up later in the movie and purposely be like, you mark that marker paid, you mark it paid, and so on and so forth, I would have kind of bought the idea that he was trying to keep it a secret that this was the job that he hired John to do. But weirdly, Winston killed that bit of plot point.
Right, and, yeah.
And I feel bad about it because I love Winston. I love Ian McShane. I love his character, and I'm curious to see where it's going and everything. But yeah, no, that's kind of a big, oh man, that just took my wind out of my sails. Hold on, I gotta take a point off of the score now. Okay, point taken off. Moving on. So yeah, wow, that's terrible. But you know what? You know what we do get? We get a lot of amazing action.
Sure do.
A lot of outstanding action. What surprised me most was Common, the rapper, standing toe to toe with Keanu Reeves. I was kind of surprised by that. I didn't think he'd be much of an actor.
Which one was he again?
I still don't think he's much of an actor, but I felt he was okay. He was the bodyguard of the sister that kept coming after John.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah, I thought he was good. I did like him a lot. I kind of liked the... I like the shot when they were walking through the subway terminal or whatever, when John's down below, the guy's up top.
And they're doing the casual, taking pot shots at each other, literal pot shots at each other.
Yes,
that was outstanding.
Yeah, again, it's frustrating. See, again, I guess my biggest problem with this movie is that there are moments in here where my brain now is kicking in and saying, okay, but why? And, like, again, that scene looks really good. I like the look of it. It was sort of fun. The two of them, again, two of them trying to just sort of, like looking like they're not doing anything, pop, 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 and the shots are going off, and he's every time he'd walk by the columns or whatever. I mean, it worked nicely. But then again, I said to myself, okay, why are they trying to look so stealthy all of a sudden? Before, they would just drop any, you know, drop any pretense and just start shooting at each other. You know, the hands would go out, boom, 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 people would scream and scatter. Like, why now are they trying to look all stealthy? So again, I just, a lot of little confusing things that I didn't quite get.
You're putting chinks in the armor.
I'm totally ruining this for you now.
you're totally putting chinks in the armor, because you're right, it doesn't, because literally 5 minutes later, they'll be in the subway itself beating the crap out of each other while everybody's just kind of hanging back.
Right, yeah. So again, I'm not quite getting, like, why are we stealthy at some moments, why are we not? I don't know.
Damn it, Joe. The movie, you know what the problem is? This goes back to my magic theory. I got fooled by the magic by this movie, and you saw the man behind the curtain. Damn you. Damn you.
But again, I like I said, I'm not really, it is the bottom line is that it's a trade-off. The filmmakers made a trade-off and said, look, we're going to, rather than focus on an airtight story, and even, again, the first one was not exactly an airtight story. I mean, there was a lot of, you could have sat there, you know, going, well, wait a minute, how does this work, and how does that work, and, you know, I think there was sort of plenty of room in the first one to sort of go, okay, well, why here, and why that, and why this? But for some reason, that one just kind of, it dazzled enough that you didn't stop to think about it. And I kind of felt like this one now, because it didn't go the extra mile. Like I said, I mean, the first one went the extra mile to ground things in certain ways and to kind of just keep one foot on the ground enough that you didn't, you know, have a lot of questions. This one kind of just felt a little short. And the focus was on over the top action and stunts, which is awesome, you know, so it's not a complaint, but it did leave some room to, yeah, you know, made you wonder, made you ask questions. So, and I just kind of found myself a couple times after watching, and again, by the way, this is my second viewing. I mean, I did see this, I saw this in the theater when it came out, and I remember specifically our very first episode one, I literally had just seen it. So, you know, in our, you know, preliminary conversations, I said, oh, I just saw John Wick 2, headshots the movie. And I said, even back then, it's really good. The action's great. And I said, you know, they probably go a little too far into the whole underworld thing. So it gets a little more, you know, fanciful, you know, a little more fantasy-ish. You know, but I don't remember really getting so off track. Like, it didn't pull me out of the fun of watching it. The second time around, I'm watching it again, but I am noticing all these other things more. Again, it feels more fantasy than reality, like the first one was. I mean, again, the first one was not exactly what I would call reality, but again, it just did it enough to not have you asking a lot of questions. And this one, they just decided, let's just go and have fun with it. So the questions kind of start bubbling to the surface, and okay, so that's sort of where I'm at. Again, does it mean I don't like it? No. Does it mean I didn't enjoy it as much as the first? No. I really did enjoy both. So again, if they did the same thing just a second time, you know, you'd probably be saying, well, all right, well, they just did the same thing again, didn't really do anything new. So they did things new. They did things that were new, and they got a little more into different things, a little more carried away. But again, it does feel like the plot is it's not nuanced at all as it was with the first one. The first one had, it gave you some depth, it gave you a little bit of layering, so that when John Wick goes off the edge, you can understand why. Here, you just get craziness. You just get, oh, this guy does this, and then he back betrays him, and then yada, yada, yada. So it's, again, just not exactly in-depth sort of stuff, but still works.
It does, in many respects. I guess I was blinded by the action, dude. I'll be honest with you. because the plot holes that you're bringing up make sense. For what it is, for what it's supposed to do, it accomplishes that. But yeah, it is a little less solid than the first movie. I thought that the world building was neat, but then it got a little over the top. I found that scene where Winston was with this guy who was showing off a whole bunch of coins and, like, take those out and distribute them. I wasn't 100% sure what the hell the point of that scene was. You know, is there a counterfeiting thing going on? Is there a smuggling thing going on? You know, there were little bits of world building that didn't really make a lot of sense to me. This was going to be my portion where I was going to start talking about the things that I found a little weird. I also found weird the scene where he stabs the guy on the train and says, "I just stabbed your aorta. If you pull it out, you die. Consider it a professional courtesy." And I was like, okay, that's a nice callback and everything like that. And I'm no doctor, but I am pretty sure that's not how the aorta works.
Right. Yeah. Right. So the guy just has to live forever on the train with a knife in him, can't ever move, or else he'll die.
Yeah. And he's in the sequel. He shows up in the credits in the sequel, so he's coming back.
Oh, okay. Well, you know, honestly, that was another thing that I kind of just could not get over. There was a part where he's fighting a huge, like, sumo-sized guy.
I think he was a sumo wrestler, actually, yes.
He stabs him a couple times, shoots him like once in the head, and the guy, he's almost down, and then the guy's not quite dead, he has to shoot him in the head again. So it's just like, at that point, it's like, and there was a lot of that. It's like, I mean, everybody's getting stabbed, shot, all kinds of things, and nobody's dying, you know? So, you know, again, the fantasy part is really just on full display. And by the way, kind of getting back to what I said earlier about, like, I'm getting to where John Wick does so many things wrong that I'm starting to question how and why he got so, you know, he got to where he is in the society. Well, then you get to the scene at the end where the two guys are in the hotel and Winston says, "Do not do anything on the property of the hotel." Right. And he just shoots him. And okay. I'm kind of getting to where, like, I get it. John Wick is completely ruled by his emotions. He does not make any smart choices. And now the whole world's going to come down on him. And all he had to do was just tell the guy, like, "I'll get you when you're outside. I will get you in 30 seconds. When you walk out that door, I will kill you." So,
Well, in John Wick's defense, the guy was taunting him about how he never has to leave the Continental. He can take care of all of his stuff from here. They'll feed him something. He can eat a different meal every day. He was taunting him like that. So I can understand where his emotions get the better of him.
But but you could make that same argument for all kinds of people in all kinds of situations. It doesn't mean...
I'm not saying it's right.
Yeah. I that's all it takes to get under John Wick's... The guy has put John Wick through the ringer. I mean, he destroyed his house. He did all kinds of things. You're absolutely right. But the idea that, I mean, seriously, like literally, like, I will, you know, you want to live in this hotel forever? Like, can you do that? Is that a thing? I don't know. But I don't know. I just felt like when that happened, I go, all right, now John Wick did something else wrong. And now there's going to be a mountain of shit on him. And even at that point, like, can he just say to Winston, "Hey, Winston, this guy broke rules. He put a contract out on me after I did his thing." I kind of feel like there's no other recourse at that point for a guy who's supposed to be cool headed and smart like John Wick, just to sit there and have the guy go, "Nah, nah." So he pulls the trigger and now he's totally excommunicated. Now the whole world's going to hunt him down. And by the way, I don't quite understand why excommunicado also means that you must be killed and there must be a bounty on your head.
I guess I don't know. The only interpretation that I can come up with is that maybe there's a latent amount of suicidal behavior in John Wick.
I suppose.
And listen, dude, I'm probably giving more credit to the screenplay than is probably intended. when I come up with this. It's the only thing I could think of, because you're right. He is, you know, in the first one, he is cool and he is calculated and he is, you know, all on top of all these things. And in this one, he's not quite there. He's almost more emotional now than in the first one, when he had an exceptional reason in the first one to still be as emotional as he was.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. There you go. So, I mean, I'm saying to myself, I get the whole idea that he retired, had a wife, and everything was wonderful. And then when that came to an end, boom, he totally unraveled and went nuts. But now I kind of feel like now you're sort of dealing with, like, now I think we should be dealing with the John Wick who we would have known prior to the first one, who was in that life, who was in that world, you know, who's balanced and calculated and whatever, but he's not. He's this emotional wreck. Okay, I guess, yeah, still, you know, I guess that does make sense as an extension of the last film, but I don't know. So, yeah, I it's like, well, if you're going to show me all of these things that he's doing wrong, I'm starting to now doubt that he would be this smart guy if he keeps making these kinds of mistakes.
Hmm. Yeah, I kind of see what you're talking about here.
But I have a hunch when we get to our points, you're going to be annoyed with me.
I already am annoyed with you because you're pointing out stuff that makes sense. It's like, you know, I mean, we've had our share of debates here and there on things we've disagreed about and everything like that. It's always usually been relatively respectful and everything like that. This is one of those situations where I really want to reach through the camera and choke you, because it's like, why are you telling me there's no Santa Claus? Why?
Yeah. And it's funny, too, because I kind of feel like, you know, sometimes I just say to myself, movie reviewing, you know, discussing and critiquing film, there are some times when it's probably just so arbitrary, because I can watch some films where I know exactly what they're doing. I know not everything makes sense, and I'm completely willing to shut my brain off. And then there's other times when I could be watching a very similar movie, and for some reason my brain is kicking in and saying, wait a second. And I don't know why that is. You know, I mean, again, like I said, I think it's because that they were smart enough to keep the first one grounded, et cetera, et cetera. And this time they opted not to. But again, is it all that, or is it just this? Sometimes your brain just kind of kicks on when you don't want it to, you know. It goes, hey, wait a second, you know.
I'm gonna agree with that, because you know it still confirms my theory of movies being magic. You know that it can, all it takes is that moment to ruin the magic spell, and it becomes a house of cards. It all falls apart.
Yeah,
and it's even worse when there's been time in between the time you've seen the movie and later. Like, look, I'll be the first to admit, you know, I gave 10 to Avengers Endgame. I'm totally not going to feel that way in a couple of years, that it's still a 10 movie. I know this. I'm not, but, you know, I gave my feelings of it at the time.
Yeah.
So perspective can sometimes be both a friend and an enemy to the reviewer.
Yeah, true.
But honestly, I'm not going to fault you for, you know, picking the thorns off of the movie and showing them to me. I can't. That's part of your job as being a reviewer. I've done it to you a couple of times, and this is now it's your time to do it to me. So I no regrets, dude. I joke with you, but I appreciate very much that, you know, you're keeping true to the Without Remorse title in our name.
There you go. Good way to look at it.
How good to see you again so soon, Mr. Week.
I need you to do this task.
I'm not that guy anymore.
You are always that guy, John.
I can't help you.
You know the rules. If you don't do this, you know the consequences.
Well, let's look at it another way. Hey, Joe. I'm going to go first, if you don't mind.
Feel free.
With the scoring. Okay. I originally came into this with a 7, because I'm not stupid. It's not a perfect movie. It's not a very, it's not a solidly plotted movie as the first one. I just had fun. The thing about it is when I came into this movie, I said to myself, no matter what happens, the action's going to be insane. And boom, check that box off. Absolutely, the action was insane. I gave this movie a 6 in the end because I did deduct the point off when I got the you had to push my face into the pee. You had to, Joe. It's okay. I had to learn my lesson. You're absolutely right. There are parts of the plot in this movie that just don't make sense, and I am the hugest defender of plot. You know that. To me, it's always plot and character. And the bottom line is this movie does take a step back in both plot and character. But it's still an enjoyable eye candy movie, so I'm going to recommend it. And I'm going to go a little bit above recommendation because it is viscerally pleasing. It's very difficult to not enjoy yourself with this movie. You know, you look up and there's just always something beautiful going up on the screen that you just like, oh man, that's outstanding. So yeah, I'm sticking with my 6 and I'm pretty proud of it actually.
Alrighty. This is the part that might burn you a little bit, because I'm going to give it an 8.
Switch, son of a bitch!
Right, after completely ruining it for you, I'm going to tell you that I'm scoring it an 8, even though, I gave the first one an 8, and I'm going to give this one an 8. And again, for as much as I'm probably giving this a very lopsided review, by focusing on a lot of the plot points that were very confusing, if not just sort of backwards, it does trade off by giving you a full-blown action film, a lot of color, a lot of style, a lot of fun. And I acknowledge that this was a conscious decision of these filmmakers, and it's probably the next logical step. I think I probably said that I gave the last one like a high 8. This one I would probably call more a lower 8. I feel like this is definitely an A-, B-plus sort of a movie as opposed to the first one, which was probably a solid A. But again, I do feel that as much as I'm picking on it, it does deliver, and I'm always, when a film delivers what it wants to do, when it says, here's what we're going to give you, and they follow through with that, that to me is a very successful, that's a success. So, yeah, again, like I said, I'm sorry I kind of pissed on your parade, but I did sort of feel like I kind of knew that going into this and still sort of walked out feeling like they delivered on what they promised. I told you you were not going to like that.
Son of a bitch. For a second there, I thought you were going to put it in a 4, actually. So you really, that was good, man. You really did me well.
Jab,
there.
Jab, jab, uppercut.
Body blow. Okay. Well, in that case, who asked you, sir? I'm going to let you go first because I'm still quite miffed at your deft execution of the bait and switch.
My who asked you is not very interesting. It's really just going to be everything I said so far, with specifically in terms of plot, in terms of, there was a conscious decision to not be realistic with this one and just sort of go crazy and have fun. So yeah, the silliness and the over the top, and I'll be specific and say that it's the part of the plot where, again, the guy hires John Wick to do the thing, then he puts a hit on him, a bounty on him. Don't quite get why. If the whole follow up was just a backlash, like again the I forget the guy's name, but the bodyguard of the sister. Like, if the backlash that John Wick had after that was, not so much the bounty on that they put on him, but just the backlash of the bodyguards coming after him or whatever, I probably wouldn't have questioned so much. But the whole bounty thing and then the code and you can't kill people on property. And so it just kind of got so convoluted that I wasn't understanding it anymore. Like, again, if there's rules, then why is Winston kind of not... Like, somebody's missing something here, and I kind of was just sort of feeling like it was just kind of a little bit of a lazy conceit on the part of the storytelling. So yeah, I mean that's I'll just leave it at that and say I kind of feel like I wonder how this movie would have been had they made a little more effort to keep it grounded.
All right, I will grant you that, and you're absolutely right. Now for me, I'm almost a little embarrassed by my who asked you, because this movie is so over the top. I don't know what it is about the A order thing that just annoys the hell out of me. There's just something about that scene that I can't put my finger on it, but him, you know, saying it and Common sitting there trying his best not to move. And I'm having this flashback to this episode of MASH where, you know, this guy got shot in the aorta and they're trying to keep him alive and they've only got like 60 minutes or something like that, or he'll get paralyzed. And it just, this whole convoluted thing happened at the mention of the word aorta. Some kind of trauma in my life is related to the word aorta. That just, when that scene happened, it just annoyed me. And it took me like a good 3 or 4 minutes before I could get back into the movie.
Yeah.
And I don't even have a suggestion how to fix it. If you, it's kind of like, it's almost like I went to like a really good 10-course meal and somebody decided to serve beets. I hate beets. that's really what it is. You know, just for 1 second, all the 11 other courses were fine and perfect. But for some reason, the goddamn beets are just bothering the hell out of me.
it takes the over the topness just a little too far. I mean, for God's sakes, I mean, the guy's sitting there with a knife in his heart. I guess he can't actually scream, but like, look like you're in pain. Yeah, I mean, these guys are too cool for words. So the guy's sitting there with a knife in his heart and he looks uncomfortable at best, you know?
Well, I would say he's a little uncomfortable for sure, yeah. But conversely, for your consideration.
I think the basic line of I'll have a tasting or I want a tasting, I think that was sort of that was almost like the moment where you sort of understood the trade-off. I kind of felt like when they were, you know, when he goes to the thing and he asks for a tasting, I kind of, at that moment, I was thinking to myself, all right, that's the payoff. We're getting a little too silly, a little too carried away, but cool scenes like that, cool moments like that, that's what the payoff was. So I will say that was sort of my moment where I was like, that's, now I get it.
For me, dude, and it feels like low-hanging fruit, but I can't help it, the technical aspect of the filming in the mirror room, I was just fascinated with. That whole sequence in the room of mirrors, yeah, near the end, I just found myself enthralled by, because I was like, holy smoke, there's mirrors everywhere, and you know, somehow they're making they're using the motion just right. You're understanding everything that's going on, even though there's a slight bit of confusionness. There is no reflection of any camera anywhere.
Yeah.
And I know that it's a combination of digital tricks and angles and stuff like that, but that alone is enough to just impress me. It's like, that's such an amazing amount of technical knowledge, of planning, of like literally every single group coming together, collaborating to make that one scene look as good as it did. I was fascinated by that scene. And in fact, like I said, I watched it twice. The first time I was paying close attention to it. The second time, at my work, every once in a while, because I work overnight shift, they'll throw a movie on to help people stay awake.
Yeah.
And, you know, I would look up every once in a while to watch John Wick 2 as they were watching it. But when that sequence came on again, I basically stopped everything I was doing and just watched it again.
Yeah.
Just so enthralled by the technical achievement of it. So, yeah, I'm going to call that one out.
I don't blame you. That was a great shot.
And thus ends John Wick Chapter 2. But we have a third chapter coming, ladies and gentlemen.
John Wick 3. Parabellum.
Yeah, whatever that means.
I was going to say, do you know what that means?
I'm assuming the movie is going to sort of semi-explain it to us.
Uh-huh.
Now, I got to be honest, Joe, I'm a little concerned because, you know, how often do the third movies actually work out?
I'll go on record and say there have been some trilogies that held it together, and I'm hoping this will be another one. And I kind of feel like, based on the first two, and again, it's there, you know, again, even though there are things about the second one that I will sort of poke holes at, the word incompetent does not come to mind. I mean, these are both very competent, able films that deliver, you know, good action for, you know, action consumers. So I got my fingers crossed that this will also be a good time.
Well, I am looking forward to it, but, you know, cautiously looking forward to it. But then again, that's kind of how I try to approach all movies anyway, because If I go in too excited, I get knocked down. If I go in, you know what I'm saying.
There you go.
All right, so busy weekend ahead. Busy weekend ahead. And on that note, my man, thank you so much for being patient with me. Really appreciate it.
Not a problem. I had a busy week myself, so.
All right. So until next time, good night, ladies and gentlemen.
My friend, have a good one. See you next week. Pistolero!
Thanks for listening to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Join us here every Thursday for a new episode. And be sure to check out the Reviews Without Remorse channel on YouTube for spoiler-free reviews of new releases. If you enjoyed this podcast, please consider becoming a patron. You can find our page on patreon.com. As little as $1 a month goes a long way. All clips in this podcast are used for commentary and critique, and is considered fair use. No copyright infringement is intended.
See, this elephant had this little dwarf trainer, and just used to put a little ballerina skirt on that elephant. I'd go around in circling, like that. That's why I thought it was so laughable at the time. There's a rumor going around the circus that dwarf and the elephant were lovers. Oh, they had to shoot the elephant. I don't know whether it's because of rumor or not, but they're buried together. Big tombstone. Guess it's not elephants, huh?
No.
Just I was at this freak show one time and I saw these Siamese elephants. Joined at the end. They was joined at the end of their trunks like that. And this trainer make them stand up on their back feet like that, and it had their trunk stretched like that. Then this little monkey had come out. There and dance a merengue right out there. I kind of felt sorry for them. They couldn't go like the other elephants when they go. All they could do is just low and go.
Norton.
One sneezes, the other's eyes get real big.
assholes do.